This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Man Who Would Be King, Rudyard Kipling's Adventure of Ambition by Rudyard Kipling. The Man Who Would Be King. Brother to a prince, and fellow to a beggar if he be found worthy. The law, as quoted, lays down a fair conduct of life, and one not easy to follow. I have been fellow to a beggar, again and again, under circumstances which prevented either of us finding out whether the other was worthy. I have still to be brother to a prince, though I once came near to kinship with what might have been a veritable king, and was promised the reversion of a kingdom, army, law courts, revenue, and policy all complete. But today, I greatly fear that my king is dead, and if I want a crown, I must go hunt it for myself. The beginning of everything was in a railway train upon the road to Meaux from Amur. There had been a deficit in the budget, which necessitated traveling, not second class, which is only half as dear as first class, but by intermediate, which is very awful indeed. There are no cushions in the intermediate class, and the population are either intermediate, which is Eurasian, or native, which for a long night journey is nasty, or loafer, which is amusing though intoxicated. Intermediates do not buy from refreshment rooms. They carry their food in bundles and pots, and buy sweets from the native sweetmeat sellers, and drink the roadside water. This is why in hot weather intermediates are taken out of the carriages dead, and in all weathers are most properly looked down upon. My particular intermediate happened to be empty till I reached Nasirabad, when the big black-browed gentleman in shirt sleeves entered, and following the custom of intermediates, passed the time of day. He was a wanderer and a vagabond like myself, but with an educated taste for whiskey. He told tales of things he had seen and done, of out-of-the-way corners of the empire into which he had penetrated, and of adventures in which he risked his life for a few days' food. If India was filled with men like you and me, not knowing more than the crows where they'd get their next day's rations, it isn't 70 millions of revenue the land would be paying, it's 700 millions, said he, and as I looked at his mouth and chin I was disposed to agree with him. We talked politics, the politics of loaferdom that sees things from the underside where the lath and plaster is not smoothed off, and we talked postal arrangements because my friend wanted to send a telegram back from the next station to Amur, the turning-off place from the Bombay to the Mo line as you travel westward. My friend had no money beyond 8 annas which he wanted for dinner, and I had no money at all, owing to the hitch in the budget before mentioned. Further, I was going into a wilderness where, though I should resume touch with the treasury, there were no telegraph offices. I was, therefore, unable to help him in any way. We might threaten a station master and make him send a wire on tick, said my friend, but that'd mean inquiries for you and for me, and I've got my hands full these days. Did you say you were traveling back along this line within any days? Within 10, I said. Can't you make it 8, said he. Mine is rather urgent business. I can send your telegrams within 10 days if that will serve you, I said. I couldn't trust the wire to fetch him, now I think of it. It's this way. He leaves Delhi on the 23rd for Bombay. That means he'll be running through Amur about the night of the 23rd. But I'm going into the Indian desert, I explained. Well and good, said he. You'll be changing at Marwar Junction to get into Jodhpur territory. You must do that, and he'll be coming through Marwar Junction in the early morning of the 24th by the Bombay mail. Can you be at Marwar Junction on that time? He won't be inconveniencing you, because I know that there's precious few pickings to be got out of these central India states, even though you pretend to be correspondent of the backwoodsman. Have you ever tried that trick? I asked. Again and again, but the residents find you out, and then you get escorted to the border before you've time to get your knife into them. But about my friend here. I must give him a word, O mouth, to tell him what's come to me, or else he won't know where to go. I would take it more than kind of you if you was to come out of central India in time to catch him at Marwar Junction and say to him he has gone south for the week. He'll know what that means. He's a big man with a red beard, and a great swell he is. You'll find him sleeping like a gentleman with all his luggage round him in a second-class apartment. But don't you be afraid. Slip down the window and say he has gone south for the week, and he'll tumble. It's only cutting your time of stay in those parts by 2 days. I ask you as a stranger going to the west, he said with emphasis. Where have you come from? Said I. From the east, said he, and I am hoping that you will give him the message on the square, for the sake of my mother as well as your own. Englishmen are not usually softened by appeals to the memory of their mothers, but for certain reasons, which will be fully apparent, I saw fit to agree. It's more than a little matter, said he, and that's why I asked you to do it, and now I know that I can depend on you doing it. A second-class carriage at Marwar Junction, and a red-haired man asleep in it. You'll be sure to remember. I get out at the next station, and I must hold on there till he comes or sends me what I want. I'll give the message if I catch him, I said, and for the sake of your mother as well as mine, I'll give you a word of advice. Don't try to run the Central India States just now as the correspondent of the Backwoodsman. There's a real one knocking about here, and it might lead to trouble. Thank you, said he simply, and when will the swine be gone? I can't starve because he's ruining my work. I wanted to get hold of the Digamber Rajah down here about his father's widow and give him a jump. What did he do to his father's widow then? Filled her up with red pepper and slippered her to death as she hung from a beam. I found that out myself, and I'm the only man that would dare going into the state to get hush money for it. They'll try to poison me, same as they did in Chortumna when I went on the loot there. But you'll give the man at Marwar Junction my message? He got out at a little roadside station, and I reflected. I had heard more than once of men personating correspondents of newspapers and bleeding small native states with threats of exposure, but I had never met any of the caste before. They lead a hard life and generally die with great suddenness. The native states have a wholesome horror of English newspapers, which may throw light on their peculiar methods of government, and do their best to choke correspondents with champagne or drive them out of their mind with four-in-hand barouches. They do not understand that nobody cares a straw for the internal administration of native states so long as oppression and crime are kept within decent limits, and the ruler is not drugged, drunk, or diseased from one end of the year to the other. They are the dark places of the earth, full of unimaginable cruelty, touching the railway and the telegraph on one side, and on the other, the days of Harun al-Rashid. When I left the train, I did business with divers kings, and in 8 days passed through many.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.